Okay, welcome back. We are nearing the end of the first session, but we're not going to end it before having Peter Campbell deliver the keynote speech of this meeting into it. Peter Campbell, he used to be one of the co-organizers for actually, I think, at least three meetings in a row. And for this one, he's not a co-organizer anymore, as his research interests have slightly shifted, and we're constantly rotating chairs, at least slightly, from meeting to meeting. But we thought we're not going to let Peter off the hook. And although he's not a co-organizer, he had to be here, we felt, given the timeliness of his research, although it's largely not on cancer, but for understanding the molecular process of mutation and cancer, that may lead to cancer in different tissues. So I'm very happy that Peter did not decline our invitation and said yes when we said we were going to have him join as a keynote speaker. Peter Campbell is the head of cancer aging and somatic mutation at the Wellcome Trust Sanger Institute. He's a senior group leader there. His research program focuses on how genetic changes in our cells are acquired as we live, and how this may relate to aging, cancer, and other disease processes. Peter has many years been very active in cancer genomics, actually since the early days, studying patterns of mutagenesis, patterns of genomic rearrangement, and patterns of cancer evolution, the diversity of tumors, and has inspired many of us in what he did there. And he continues to do so in studying now somatic mutations more from the angle of how they arise somatically and potentially may later result in disease processes. And Peter, I'm not going to make this introduction much longer because it would eat up too much of the time that you will take to explain us what you're doing. So I'm going to just say welcome once more, and I look forward to your presentation now.
Thanks, Jan. I'm going to, thanks for the introduction. I'm just going to share my screen, if I can work out how to do that. Which is, for some reason, causing some... Oh, you are kidding me. Hang on. Sorry, there's some technical issue here. Right, that's better. Right. Okay. You should be able to see this.
We do see your screen now. Yes, we do.
You can. Excellent. So if I go to this, you now be able to see it full screen, and we can get rid of that. Right. Okay. Excellent. I can start. So thanks. As Jan said, we've recently begun to explore the landscape of somatic mutations in tissues beyond what we see in a cancer genome. And the reason really for that is that when one sequences a cancer genome, we can kind of reconstruct the clonal structure of that cancer genome and identify subclones and driver mutations and so on. But really, the subclones and so on that we detect are really only post-date, by definition, the emergence of the most recent common ancestor in the cell. And for most of the tumor types that we've sequenced over the years, that most recent common ancestor is emerging variable times prior to diagnosis, but usually within the last kind of 10 to 20 years before diagnosis. And we have very little insight into the mutational landscape of the cells before that most recent common ancestor. And really, to get at that sort of question, one needs to go direct to normal cells and sequence normal cells to see what's going on in all of these organ systems. And we've been having a whale of a time chugging through a range of organs and looking at the patterns of mutations in normal tissues within those organs across the lifespan. What's beginning to emerge is that these mutational processes that are acting in normal tissues have consequences beyond those that we might have imagined in terms of promoting cancer, but also seem to have a relationship to other disease processes and to kind of beginning to reshape the way that we think about selection in normal normal tissues and how that relates to cancer. And I think if I had to sum up my talk in one message, it's that positive selection can lead to consequences beyond cancer, that there's a richer landscape of positive selection in tissues beyond cancer. You'll see a lot of phylogenetic trees in my talk. So just to kind of refresh your memory on what a phylogenetic tree is essentially when we think about somatic cells, a phylogenetic tree really represents a lineage tree. And so when we start life as a fertilized egg, from the outset, from that first cell division and every cell division thereafter, there's a risk that the cells will acquire mutations. As they acquire those mutations, because the genome is big and the mutation rate is not very high, those mutations tend to be relatively unique from cell to cell. And that allows us to, if we sequence the genomes of the cells at the end, we can kind of look at the patterns of sharing and unique mutations and reconstruct a phylogenetic tree from the mutations. Now, what you'll see as we go through some of the phylogenetic trees, you'll be well used to phylogenetic trees in the setting of cancer, where you have a very long trunk that represents all of the mutations seen in the most recent common ancestor, and then periods of subclonal diversification within the tumor that represent kind of subclones of that original most recent common ancestor. When we look at normal tissues, what we tend to see is much more polyclonal populations, and therefore that the phylogenetic trees look a bit different. But the principles are basically the same as what we imagine when we sequence a cancer genome. Now, what we found is that as we have sequenced a range of normal tissues, we found, and Luke showed this today with the brain and the heart, we tend to find an increasing burden of somatic mutations with age. And that's pretty much every tissue that we've looked at to date, including many post-mitotic tissues, show this linear increase in mutation burden with age. Basically, what that means is that for most cell types, the genome is kind of ticking at a constant mutation rate throughout life. There's a constant mutational clock. It varies. The rate of that clock varies from tissue to tissue. So, for example, as Rahela presented, in germ cells, the rate is much lower than in somatic cells. In somatic cells, the rate can vary from about 15 to 20 mutations per cell per year in blood, up to about 40 to 50 mutations per cell per year in colon. And there is some evidence for person-to-person variation in the rate at which this clock ticks, but actually it's not that much variation. Most people are ticking away at a pretty much the same rate in all of their different tissues, and acquiring mutations in a fairly random way per cell. One of the other fascinating things that's emerged from these studies is that there is a rich landscape of positive selection in normal tissues. And we see in some normal tissues, particularly esophagus, but also endometrium and lung and skin, that the density of driver mutations by the time someone is middle-aged or elderly can really be quite spectacularly high, such that something like 50 to 80% of cells within the esophagus will have at least one driver mutation by the time someone is 60 or 70. And that's really a very high rate. It's driven by essentially two forces that are acting on the esophagus. You get both an increase in the number of driver mutations because of the linear increase in mutation burden with age. So the number of driver mutations is linearly increasing, but also each of the clones that gets those driver mutations is beginning its own clonal expansion, so that you get this more than linear increase in the fraction of cells that have a driver mutation with age. And I'll drill into this in a bit more detail in blood in a second. So that's really the kind of background, if you like, and I'm just going to concentrate now on two stories, one in blood and one in liver, that kind of drill into this landscape of mutation and selection with aging and with disease. So for the blood study, what we did was, this was work led by Emily Mitchell, who's a fantastic PhD student, clinical PhD student in the group. And she took 10 unselected normal individuals from a range of age, two cord blood samples, so from neonates, and then eight adult individuals up to the age of 81, four who we classify as young, i.e. less than 70, and four who we classify as elderly. And she did a rather heroic job of taking their bone marrow, sorting hematopoietic stem cell progenitor cells as single cells, and then essentially expanding them in vitro into single cell derived colonies and sequencing the genomes of those colonies. And she sequenced 300 to 400 genomes from these colonies per individual, and so that the whole data set is about 3,500 whole genomes from these colonies. And then she, from the genomes, she reconstructs the phylogenetic tree, and then we make inferences about the sort of patterns that we see. As you would expect, the mutation burden increases linearly with age, like it does in every other tissue. And there's really very little within person variation. This is only a little bit more than Poisson variation, really. And certainly when one corrects for sequencing depth and the like, it seems like most cells have broadly equal numbers of mutations within an individual. So I'm going to show you, I'm going to flip through all of the adult phylogenetic trees just to kind of give you a sense. I'm going to flip through them in age order, just to give you a sense of the changes in clonal structure of the hematopoietic stem cell compartment with age. So this is the youngest adult in our cohort. And essentially we're looking at the phylogenetic tree of about 400 colonies here. And essentially, you remember that I said that the phylogenetic tree for normal tissues looks different to what you might see in a cancer. So we don't see one long trunk. That's because there are very many hematopoietic stem cells. We think about 100 to 200,000, and each of them are contributing to hematopoiesis at any given moment in time. And those hematopoietic stem cells are essentially clonally unrelated to one another. So we see this kind of almost what looks like a comb, where we have a kind of broad line across the top with these branch points in the phylogenetic tree. And then in this particular individual, we see occasional branch points in the phylogenetic tree. Now, these individual branch points that we're seeing essentially represent historic stem cell divisions within the bone marrow. So this pair of cells here, for example, if you can see the hand cursor overlying this branch point in the phylogenetic tree, this branch represents a stem cell that had this many mutations and existed when this person was about 15 to 20, and that cell divided, and then the two daughter cells, 15 years later, we are sequencing the progeny of those two daughter cells all those years later. Now you can see we've done two things to this phylogenetic tree. We've normalized it to age because we know that the mutation rate is constant throughout life, so we can essentially scale the phylogenetic tree to age. And we've then added in various annotations onto the phylogenetic tree. So we've marked any clones which have a known driver mutation that we might see in a blood cancer. And although this individual doesn't have any, you'll see in blue occasional clones which we've marked with a light blue color that represent clones that have expanded to more than 1% of blood production in that individual. And in the males, we're also marking clones that have lost the Y chromosome for reasons that you'll see in a minute. So this is the youngest patient, the youngest individual in the study, not a patient, a normal individual in our study, essentially exactly what you might imagine his bone marrow to look like. And all of the young individuals show essentially the same pattern. Here's the second young individual. This one individual has an expanded clone, so more than a clone that accounts for more than 1% of the hematopoiesis in this individual, and one driver mutation, and one clone that's lost the Y chromosome, but broadly speaking, a fairly similar pattern to what we saw in the other young individual, hugely polyclonal, very few branch points in the phylogenetic tree. The young individual who's age 48, again, similar sort of pattern, not much in the way of clonal expansions. A few more clones that have lost the Y chromosome, as you can see, maybe a few more branch points in the phylogenetic tree, but certainly nothing very much. And then the 63-year-old, again, a similar pattern. Here's an expanded clone that has lost the Y chromosome. Again, rather more in the way of independent clones losing the Y chromosome, perhaps a few more branch points in the phylogenetic tree, but still hugely polyclonal. Now, I've been building this up, so it won't surprise you to know that this completely changes after the age of 70. So what we see in pretty much all of the elderly individuals is a pattern that looks much more like this. So what we're seeing here are many more branch points in the phylogenetic tree, as you can see, many more clones that have expanded to account for more than 1% of blood production, as you can see shown in the blue, perhaps a few more driver mutations, as you can see, some red D and MT3A mutations, some orange TET2 mutations. But what's really quite striking in this man is that the is that most of these clonal expansions that are accounting for more than 1% of blood production each do not have known driver mutations. So these are clonal expansions occurring in the absence of known driver mutations. This is the 76-year-old, 76-year-old female, again, a fairly similar pattern with lots of independent clones that have expanded to account for more than 1% of blood. A few drivers, but most of these expanded clones not having drivers. Here's the 77-year-old female and the 81-year-old male, again with a massive clone here, and a really remarkable amount of independent instances, no fewer than 60 independent losses of the Y chromosome in the clones that we sequenced. So that's the sort of broad pattern. Just to summarize the key findings there then, what we find is that in young individuals, hematopoiesis is highly polyclonal, many, many stem cells, 100 to 200,000 stem cells per individual, each of them contributing broadly equally to hematopoiesis. Whereas in the old individuals, hematopoiesis is much more oligoclonal, such that 30 to 60% of all blood cells in these individuals derive from 10 to 20 clones. And these clones are independent of one another, but each of them is accounting for a moderate fraction of hematopoiesis. Most of these expanded clones do not have known driver mutations, and those clonal expansions seem to begin decades earlier, as you can sort of see in this individual. You know, these clones begin their expansions decades before. This is an 81-year-old, and many of these clones have started their expansions when this person was in their 20s and 30s. So we can turn that into measures of clonal diversity, and what you can see, this is a Shannon diversity index. I mean, there are many such measures of clonal diversity. This happens to be one of the more popular ones. And what you can see in our cohort is that essentially this clonal diversity falls off a cliff after the age of 70. And it seems to be a relatively universal feature of aging. So we were kind of puzzled by this, and we went around many explanations as to why you might have a whole bunch of clonal expansions in the absence of driver mutations. One possible explanation, perhaps the most likely explanation, is that there is a whole bunch of mutations conferring selective advantage on these hematopoietic stem cells that we have yet to identify. And so to assess that question, we took advantage of this, of the fact that synonymous mutations are selectively neutral. And then from that, we can kind of assume that the synonymous mutations are measuring the background mutational rate of the genome, and then look at and quantify the excess of non-synonymous drivers mutations over those synonymous mutations. And that essentially gives us a measure of the number of drivers within a set. And we can apply that gene by gene. And indeed, we find some of the typical genes popping up as it being under positive selection. But we can also apply it across the whole genome. And that gives us an overarching global estimate of the number of driver mutations in the data set. And when we do that, what we find is that the overall non-synonymous to synonymous mutation rate is about 6% higher than we would expect by chance with quite tight confidence intervals. And what that means is that about 1 in 15 to 20 non-synonymous mutations in the data set are under positive selection within the hematopoietic stem cell compartment. Interestingly, that ratio is identical in young individuals and old individuals. And I think what is interesting about that is that it suggests that the positive selection acting on these occasional mutations, these 1 in 15 driver mutations, 1 in 15 non-synonymous mutations that are drivers rather, that the selection is starting pretty much as soon as those mutations happen. So it's a sort of model where the mutation rate is constant throughout life. Every year you acquire 15 or so extra mutations in every hematopoietic stem cell, there's a chance that each one of those mutations will confer a selective advantage on that clone, and that clonal advantage starts from the moment that the mutation is acquired. That is a genetic test for selection. We weren't sure, essentially, whether that data was enough to explain the kind of rather dramatic change in hematopoiesis after the age of 70. So to look at this, we turned to approximate Bayesian computational models, which I won't drill into the details on. But essentially what we did was we simulated hematopoietic stem cell compartments, assuming that there was a single compartment of HSCs comprising around about 100,000 HSCs, although the numbers actually don't matter all that much, self-renewing about once a year, which is the sort of estimated rate, and acquiring driver mutations at a constant rate throughout life. And then what we wanted to do was to see whether the trees that we generated would kind of reproduce the features of the trees that we observed, i.e. the sharp change after the age of 70. And what we find is that the rate of driver mutations that best fits with the data is around about 1.5 to 2 1.5 to 2 drivers every per 1,000 stem cells per year, and that is broadly similar to the rate that we estimate from the genetics. So the simulations do seem to match with the genetic data. And what's interesting is that when we look at the trees, we are able to reproduce that sharp decrease in clonal diversity after the age of 60 or 70. And indeed, when we look at kind of some of the simulated trees, this is a sort of typical pattern that we get emerging from the data, showing this sort of oligoclonal expansions, many clones expanding with driver mutations and beginning their expansions decades before we kind of stop the simulation in this case. So essentially, we are able to reproduce the observed features of the tree with what is really a very simple model of hematopoiesis, that there's a kind of constant population of hematopoietic stem cells that are acquiring somatic mutations throughout life, and a constant rate of the fraction of those mutations being driver mutations. What's interesting furthermore about that is that the large population size of hematopoietic stem cells and the relative constant rate of driver mutation, sorry, somatic mutations across individuals implies that this phenomenon will basically be seen in everybody by the time they're 70. This will be a universal feature of hematopoiesis in individuals over the age of 70. But nonetheless, which clones float to the top in a given individual will vary from person to person, and that may well have implications for consequences of these clonal expansions, such as Professor Lowe was talking about earlier today. So moving on to the other story, which is also kind of showing that that somatic mutations play a role outside of the risk of cancer. And this is a study in chronic liver disease, which, as you know, is a strong risk factor for hepatocellular carcinoma. And we were particularly interested in chronic liver diseases associated with obesity and metabolic syndrome, which is a disease called non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, and alcohol-related liver disease. These are the two most common causes of chronic liver disease in Western populations. And what we find in healthy liver, much like in blood, is that healthy liver is hugely polyclonal. The individual clones that we observe are probably only comprising a few hundred to 1,000 hepatocytes. But in cirrhotic liver, chronic liver disease, clones grow up to centimeters in size. We have this kind of histological feature of cirrhotic nodules where the hepatocytes get surrounded by fibrotic tissue. And these, what we find is that these nodules can be monoclonal or oligoclonal, and that the clones are kind of walled off by the fibrotic bands, that these are essentially the fibrotic bands kind of sequestering each clone independent, and then that clone is kind of evolves in parallel within the liver. Now, we scaled up that study, which was originally only about 450 genomes. We've now scaled up to 1,590 genomes. This was just published 2 or 3 weeks ago, with Stanley Ning being the main worker for this. So he took 34 liver samples and generated 1,590 genomes. And when we scale up this sample size, we suddenly find a whole bunch more driver mutations emerging from this. And three of these genes are particularly interesting in the context of chronic liver disease, because they all affect metabolism genes. Perhaps the most interesting of those is that we found a hotspot mutation in FOXO1. And it's always the same residue that's mutated. In fact, it's the same base pair in the genome that's mutated, and it generates a predicted change of a serine to a tryptophan at position 22. Now, FOXO1 is the key transcription factor. It's the master regulator of insulin signaling and sits downstream of the insulin receptor. So what happens when insulin binds its receptor is you get PI3K activation, AKT phosphorylation, and then AKT phosphorylates FOXO1. And it phosphorylates, one of the sites that it phosphorylates is this threonine at position 24. So phosphorylated threonine then is bound by these 14-3-3 proteins in this motif here, and FOXO1 is exported from the nucleus and degraded. And the prediction is that these mutations, if you substitute a bulky tryptophan for a serine so close to this phosphorylated threonine, is that we would prevent threonine phosphorylation and prevent this 14-3-3 export from the nucleus. And indeed, that's what we see. So when we do in vitro studies, in the presence of the mutation, even when we add insulin, the FOXO1 construct here remains stuck in the nucleus, whereas the wild type gets nicely exported from the nucleus as predicted. So essentially, these mutations are rendering the hepatocytes resistant to insulin. And as a consequence to that, what we find is that the transcriptional programs and the metabolic consequences are exactly as you would predict for a cell that's become insulin resistant. In other words, insulin has no effect on the hepatocyte metabolic program, and the hepatocytes remain in a sort of starvation program, pumping out glucose and so on. And so essentially the hepatocytes become insulin resistant as a consequence of these mutations. Curious thing, really quite striking thing about these mutations is that we see lots of convergent evolution within the same person's liver. So here are two patients from the cohort, and we've built phylogenetic trees, much like we did for the blood study. And what we find is that there are multiple independent clones that have acquired the exact same base change in FOXO1. We found up to 9 clones with FOXO1 mutations in the same patient. Really fascinatingly, these mutations are not seen in either normal liver or in hepatocellular carcinoma to anywhere near the degree that we're seeing them in chronic liver disease. A second gene that popped out is another metabolism gene. This is side B, and what side B does is regulate lipid droplet fusion in hepatocytes. And the mutations we see in this affected particularly charged residues. And the way that side B regulates lipid droplet fusion is two side B molecules on two different lobules, lipid droplets, come together And the negatively charged residues on one interact with the positively charged residues on the other, and the lipid droplets fuse. What the fact that these mutations are seen in the charged residues suggests that essentially these mutations are stopping that lipid droplet fusion. That means that the lipids will be less able to aggregate and cause problems for the hepatocytes, and therefore confer a kind of selective advantage on the clones. And much like we see with the FOXO1 mutations, we see lots of independent mutations in the same person's liver of side B. A setting of convergent evolution. And like we saw for FOXO1, these mutations are not seen in normal liver and they're not seen in hepatocellular carcinoma. So the selective advantage they're conferring is very specific to the disease phenotype. And the knockout mouse for this gene shows decreased fat accumulation in the liver, and that those knockout mice are resistant to the kind of fat accumulation in liver that you get with a Western diet. If you feed the mice a Western high fat, high sucrose diet, the mouse that's knocked out for side B has decreased accumulation of damage from that high fat diet. The third gene to kind of complete the story is GPAM. Here we see a series of nonsense frameshift and splice site mutations, and these seem to be loss of function mutations. GPAM is the rate limiting enzyme in converting free fatty acids to storage triacylglycerides in hepatocytes. And like we see for the other genes, we see convergent evolution, multiple mutations occurring in independent nodules within the same individual's liver. Like we see for the other two genes, these mutations are not seen in normal liver and they're not seen in hepatocellular carcinoma. So the knockout mice, like we saw for side B, also shows decreased fat accumulation, as you can see here. This is the knockout mouse crossed with the ob mouse that tends to accumulate fat in the liver. So it's really quite a complex story. Of the 34 patients we sequenced, 18 had at least one driver mutation. The three metabolism genes are shown here at the top. These are two other genes that are mutated in hepatocellular carcinoma. One of the striking things is that we see lots of convergent evolution within the same individual, but between different individuals, we see rather different patterns of driver mutations. So some patients, like this one, tends to throw off FOXO1 mutations. This patient tends to throw off side B mutations. This patient tends to throw off GPAM mutations. We don't really understand why this is here, but the cumulative effects are potentially quite important here. So what we did was we extrapolated how much of the liver would be affected by clones carrying mutations in one or other of these genes across the cohort. And if the liver, we used a total liver mass of about 1500 grams, you can see that there are hundreds of grams of, we predict that there are hundreds of grams of hepatocytes within these patients that are carrying one or other or several of these driver mutations, all kind of building up, stacked on top of one another, a little bit like we saw in the blood, stacked up on top of one another because of positive selection for these particular mutations. Now, why are we seeing this interpersonal divergence? Why are we seeing differences between individuals and which driver mutations are emerging? And we don't really understand this, but it is probably because of differences in the selective pressure between patients. So you can imagine that if this is your kind of liver of a healthy individual, it's got lots of mutations and lots of genes, they're tightly knit polyclonal pattern, many, many hundreds of thousands, millions even of different clones, all of which are requiring somatic mutations. You can imagine that the liver will have each gene mutated many, many thousands of times within that liver. Now you exert a specific selective pressure acting on that organ. And let's suppose that selective pressure will kill everything in the liver except for cells that happen to have the right mutation in the pink gene here. Or in the context of a different selective pressure, will kill everything except cells that have a mutation in a blue gene. then essentially after that disease, that selective pressure is active, you'll have this kind of pattern of clones that are much more kind of genomically similar, because only these are the only clones that have managed to survive that extreme selective pressure. And then over time, those clones will expand because they've survived, and the other ones will not be able to expand because they're suffering from the selective pressure. And so that's the sort of pattern you would expect to see, convergent evolution hitting the same sorts of genes within an individual. What we don't know in the setting of chronic liver disease is what is the nature of this selective pressure. But the fact that the three genes that we pulled out are all involved in lipid metabolism suggests that lipotoxicity is absolutely critical to this selective pressure. So what are the key implications of this? As you can see, we started out, when we submitted this paper, we had all four of these implications in the discussion of the paper. By the time it finished, with the process of the peer reviewers saying that too many of these conclusions were speculative, we really only finished with this blue one. But I'm going to focus on the two that I think are most solid from this data. First is, as I said, that FOXO1, side B, and GPAM mutations and their convergence point to the critical importance of lipid storage in the liver to the pathogenesis of these disease processes, and that essentially by preventing the hepatocytes being able to store the lipids, that confers a selective advantage in a selective environment where you've got lots of fat knocking around. And critically, I think for you guys, these mutations are not mutated in liver cancer. And that's really intriguing because firstly, it suggests that these pathways may actually protect the hepatocytes from malignant transformation. But it also suggests that the selective advantage that's being conferred in the setting of chronic liver disease, when you've got an excess of calories, you know, patients with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and alcohol-related liver disease, they have an excess of calories. If you're wanting to become a cancer, if you're a clone wanting to become a cancer, then interfering with your metabolism is certainly would seem unlikely to aid your quest in becoming malignant. And so maybe that's why we're not seeing these clones transforming when they have mutations in these particular genes. Whether we can exploit that therapeutically or diagnostically remains to be seen. I do think that there's a possibility that these clones may alter the function of the liver as a whole, contribute to, for example, the insulin resistance of type 2 diabetes and the metabolic syndrome, but that requires quite a lot more work than we've been able to do thus far. And that's really where I want to finish, to summarize the sort of patterns of selection that we're seeing in with aging in blood and in with disease in liver. There are a huge number of people who've contributed to this work. I particularly want to highlight Emily Mitchell, who drove the blood work together with Mike Spencer Chapman, Kevin Dawson, and Heather Machado, and also Stan Leeming, who drove the liver work with Fawad Rahani and Natalia and Simon. It was a strong collaboration with a number of collaborators, Matt on the liver side, Lisa and Jyoti on the blood side, and a long-standing good fun collaborations with Inigo, Phil, and Mike. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Peter, for this great talk. We're collecting again questions via the online platform. And while people are collecting their thoughts, I'm seeing initial questions popping up. I will ask a very broad one, Peter. These are really very remarkable observations you're making in terms of modeling the clonal dynamics in different tissues and making inferences about observations that have been made in recent years, for example, in the blood. Could you more broadly connect your observations and your current insights with the hallmarks of aging that are basically being discussed in the aging field? And to what extent do you think mutation acquisition is affecting phenotypes that we see commonly in aging.
Yes, I think that's a fascinating question. So the hallmarks of aging represent a series of possible biological processes that have been suggested might contribute to aging phenotypes. They include things like somatic mutations, which is, I guess, what we've covered here, but also things like epigenetic change, telomere attrition, mitochondrial dysfunction, reactive oxygen species, irreversible protein aggregation, stem cell exhaustion, and the like. Metabolic pathways have also been implicated. Now, what's interesting about all of these is that there's a sort of interconnectedness to these. So if one takes the example of epigenetics, for example, if you measure DNA methylation, Steve Horvath and others have shown that that you can essentially you can age someone just by the patterns of methylation in their blood to within a year or two of their true age. And when you kind of think about what does that mean, these are essentially changes at CpGs in their methylation state that are occurring as you go through life. But we're also seeing changes in the kind of clonal mix of that blood in which these methylation changes are occurring. And we're seeing lots of convergence. I showed you the loss of Y. We're seeing lots of independent loss of Y clones. We're also seeing independent convergent DNMT3A mutations. And it's a really intriguing possibility that the methylation changes that have been attributed to aging could be at least partially explained by common epigenetic consequences of clonal expansions happening in blood. So there is the possibility that these different hallmarks of aging could be unified by understanding these kind of clonal dynamics. On the other hand, it could be that they're actually representing completely independent processes happening independently of one another, and they're kind of summing up to give the phenotypes of aging. I think that's the sort of thing that really we're now with these kind of methodologies beginning to be able to unlock, and I think that's going to be a really exciting direction of travel for us over the next few years.
Great, Peter. Thanks. That's indeed fascinating. So I now see a number of questions popping up, and so we'll have two more minutes to deal with the questions now. The remaining questions we'll basically keep for the Meet the Speaker session, which follows right after this. But we need to keep the timing because people will in part switch platforms for this. So let's get started with the first question I'm seeing from Moritz Gerstung. Do you see global or cancer driver specific negative selection in liver disease in line with such mutant clones being purged in favor of metabolic mutations?
That's a really interesting question. I mean, we do not see evidence of negative selection in the sense that our measure for this is to look at the non-synonymous to synonymous mutation rate that I mentioned, where we can look at, we can apply that gene by gene, or we can apply it globally. And when we apply it globally, we tend to see consistently an elevated DNDS ratio, which suggests that that the balance is tilted towards more positive selection than negative selection. It's not to say that negative selection is completely absent, it's kind of outnumbered, if you like, by positive selection. Positive selection seems to be a more important force. So as far as we can tell, essentially mutations are not killing off hepatocytes. It's more that the disease process is killing off hepatocytes and only sparing those that have the right, if you like, the right driver mutations.
Okay, wonderful.